Let's do it live on a Tuesday edition of Cleveland Browns Daily. Merely Bo, the great Z. How you doing, buddy?
I'm fantastic. Other than the weather, feeling
this
good.
This was brutal. This
terrible.
Wind
the wind
is just...
It chills
it's a February
you.
February wind. It's not a end of March wind.
It chills you to the bone. Bone chilling.
Yeah. I was explaining that to the boys about the difference between where I grew up and here. And the big difference is out there, like, the wind really blows.
Yeah.
Like, it blows a lot. Now, you see the sun a lot more,
yeah.
But the wind is what
the wind
will,
wind will get you.
Half.
That's right. That's why they sell windproof gear.
But is it?
No.
No, I don't think so either.
Up
like
to
the
a certain
wind
extent.
Stopper. Come on.
Yeah, up to a certain extent.
Not really.
It. Yeah, that's it. Speaking of bone chilling, why don't we have great nicknames anymore? Remember James Bone Crusher Smith? Why don't we have nicknames
this is
like
why
that anymore?
I have a theory.
I'd love to hear it.
I think it's because in those days, the voice for the player, for the fan, was singular, and usually it was by the major columnist in the town.
Sure.
Or the most almost
major
oftentimes
boxing writer.
Right. Sure. It was the writer of the day would write the story. It was the one singular account. He was the voice of humanity in
yep.
that region, and he would make it so. And those guys were clever, and so they did. And now we don't have that. We you know, it was just like with our defense this year when we were looking for the name of the defense. And Jim and I talked about this, like if Jim would have been on. You know, he dealing with what he dealt with. But if he was on every game, he probably would have been the guy to name it.
Yeah.
You know, like that would have been the guy. There would have been a responsibility with that. Like if anyone's going to name it, it's got to be the voice of the team on radio. It's got to be the columnist of record.
And you need the players to like it.
And you and the player. Well, but in some instances, the players didn't even have a say.
Back then, now they do, though, because they would go on.
Yeah, they'd say, no, I'm not doing that.
Social media and make their own. No,
yeah,
this is
yeah.
who we are.
Yeah, but like Magic Johnson was coined Magic Johnson as a 17-year-old. By a writer in the Lansing fill-in-the-blank newspaper, he started calling him Magic.
Yeah.
And it pretty good.
Better than Irvin.
And probably the best use of a nickname in the history of the world.
Yeah. I wonder how Eric Sleepy Floyd got his nickname.
My guess is at a basketball camp. Wasn't paying attention.
He was sleeping.
Eric, damn it. We're going over triple threat again. Can you lock in?
Yeah, why are you so
You're
sleepy?
Always so damn sleepy.
Yeah.
I'm just going to start calling you Sleepy Floyd. That's my guess is how that went.
Great nickname.
Yeah.
Sleepy
yeah.
Floyd.
But no, they don't do it anymore. There aren't many.
No, there aren't many.
Out there now.
All right. I think we have to start with a couple of things, and then I'm going to get into a show that I just finished last night that I want to recommend to everybody.
Go ahead. Give me
Should we do the show or do a couple things?
Whatever you want. Your world. You're the franchise.
Well, it's our world. I appreciate that. But we.
No, I'm a situational point guard.
No.
Come in, play a few minutes, hit you.
No.
Hit you on the wing.
This is
every
like,
once in a while you give me a point.
We're like Maverick and Iceman. This is a Maverick
you,
and Goose.
I get you this, and then you give me this.
I'll always. I was real good at good pass.
Nice pass.
Thank you. Yes. I was great at that.
Bootsy goes this.
Yeah. Dinner. Okay, Dad.
This was real quick.
Yeah.
He's doing his math stuff last night. We were pulled in a bunch of directions, so
yeah.
We had a someone coming over and help him out with a little bit of his math. And helping him do his homework. And when I got back from dropping one of them off at AAU and then on the way to get the other at lacrosse, Beamsy goes, she goes, well, he had something. It was a pretty funny line. I'm like, oh, yeah, what did he do this time? She goes, well, Paxton, I don't think that your mom is going to be okay with that handwriting that you're writing with on your homework, that I think we probably should do it again and we need it to be a little bit neater. And Bootsy goes, my dad's from Montana. He doesn't care. Why would me being from Montana have any impact on if I care about his?
Does he think that you're communicating with like smoke signals in Montana?
I have no idea.
Is that what you're doing?
I have no idea. So I don't know what that means, but I he's probably right. I wouldn't be quite as picky about it.
I would imagine that your father didn't care about penmanship. My grandfather, my nonno, cared deeply about my penmanship.
He had a John Hancock.
His was fine, but he wanted
yours to
mine
be?
To be good because obviously English was not his first language. Mm-hmm. It was Yugoslavian or Croatian, and I remember I would have to go, you know, those books that have the lines where there's the half
yeah,
line
half
in the middle
dot, yeah,
and you do the cursive, and like if I would do them to his satisfaction I'd get some cash.
Well, that's pretty good.
Yes,
at least you're incentivized.
Oh, I was definitely incentivized.
Yeah, you weren't under some yoke.
No, I was not.
I never had good penmanship. It turns out I was right, because I remember complaining about it when I was young and like, why am I ever going to need this? And they're right. I don't. I don't write in cursive. When's the last time you wrote anything in cursive?
I write in a hybrid. I do cursive where it's convenient to connect certain letters, but for the most part, I'm
printing.
I just write.
What is your what's your signature look like? Give me your signature. Yeah. There you go.
I like my signature. So you could always pick out the N, the D, the Z, and you like yours. You can pick out the B's.
Pick out the B's. That's
it. You're a huge B.
But there are people who spend a great deal of time on that. Like my mother had impeccable penmanship.
Oh yeah.
Like her signature.
Mo Pedman
incredible.
Has absurd penmanship.
His doesn't make sense. I don't understand. It doesn't fit.
No, there's nothing about it.
It doesn't fit.
It's absurd.
The rest of his brand in any way that he would ridiculously
have. He looks like he should be writing with a quill.
It's exactly what he looks like.
Yeah.
Wearing like
a powdered
like
wig.
Like he's a notary back in the day.
Powdered
like
wig.
Go to this guy in the powdered wig, and then he's going to.
He has a seal. He's going to put a seal on it. Yeah, a little wax seal.
All right. Go ahead. A
couple things. Go ahead. Number one, welcome to the party, everybody. Welcome to the party. Yes, Maurice Hurst did say we're going to Brazil later this year. That happened like a week ago. So it was nice that my phone was blowing up about it last night.
Thanks for listening, you jerks.
Yeah. Number one. Number two.
I just don't think people listen close enough.
He was just talking speculation. Like, that's what Peter King had said we were going there. A lot of people, you know, we don't know. I can say that. Look into my eyes. We don't know yet. We don't know yet. Is it possible? Yes. But we don't know yet if we are going to Brazil. So I thought that was hilarious that it was news. He had to respond to it. The GIF where he's
the
Chris
gym.
Hinsky. Rolling down
the
in the
gym in
seat.
The office it was amazing.
Amazing.
Yeah,
I love Mo Hurst, so I'm happy for him. I was saying last night to Kel, I'm like, I feel bad for Mo Hurst right now because he's having to defend this. He's like, I'm not a reliable source, Dove. That was great. But we don't know. The Browns don't know. So there is no news on that sense. But there might be some news coming that you would consider to be dynamite.
Oh, there you go. I like what you did there, and I know exactly what you did there. Yeah, so keep it locked. Here's a little lesson for the kids.
Pay attention to the scores.
The scores are around.
They're around.
You have to pay attention.
But sometimes it's like, what was that, National Treasure? Sometimes you have to put the clues together. There were clues right there that could have led you.
That's why it's scores.
Yeah, that's why it's scores.
But
sometimes scores are scores. This is like score with a little bit of it, and you got to do a little work here. You got to do one hurdle to jump through.
Yeah.
And if you jump through it, you'll say.
There is a certain group of our audience who I think will be pretty quick to what you did.
Yeah.
And there's a certain group of our audience that will be like him.
No clue.
By the way, were you recognized? Are you getting recognized at sporting events?
That's correct.
Oh, God.
Our work here is done.
It's great.
Next level's next.
This is why he's Uno.
Yeah, somebody at Rocket Mortgage during the MAC championship called me out, and I turned around and I.
He just said, hey, Uno.
I was expecting it to be one of you guys that I knew, and it wasn't.
Hold on.
He goes, Uno. And I go, hi? He goes, go Browns, dude. I was pointing at him. I go, go Browns. My girlfriend was shocked. I was shocked, too.
You had a good night.
It was good.
Yeah, I bet you did.
Good for all.
Hey, honey, just so you know.
I'm known. It is known.
It is known that I am known.
That's right.
There's nothing better than that. That's a nice flex out of you, Uno.
That is a great
cruising
flex.
Around Rocket Mortgage, Mac tournament. Let's make things happen. Got your little chick there. Return to the Mac. All of a sudden, hey, are you?
Yeah. As a matter of fact,
I'm him.
That's right.
That's right. Is there a problem?
Oh, man. All right, my third thing, TV show I am going to implore everyone to watch. I just finished Masters of the Air.
Yep. I'm hoping this. So I actually looked into this for my flight. And I'm flying American Thursday, and they have Apple TV on the
seats. You should be able to download it to your iPad if you were so inclined, and then you don't have to worry about Wi-Fi.
I don't have my own. The kids all have them and all that. Okay. But I should be fine on that because that'll be.
I hope so. Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So it's on my short list.
It is from the same people that brought you Band of Brothers.
Yeah.
And
Hanks and Spielberg.
And what was the
Pacific?
The Pacific, which I have not watched. I have to watch that now.
Pacific is as well done. As Band of Brothers, it's just a much more grim tale.
Okay.
Like, Band of Brothers is so uplifting
in
the end, ultimately. And the Pacific is much more scattered because the space that it was fought over is so much more vast. And then the opponent is different. So that's just, you know, remember when we had Emory in here that time, that, and it was like, geez, a little different out there in the Pacific.
Yeah.
So,
well, there was Well, there were atrocities happening.
There's atrocities everywhere. A great many atrocities, but there was a different. Yeah.
So it's about the Bloody 100th. It's all factually based. It's based off of a book with the accounts from the actual pilot. So everybody's in the show. The name, they're all
just
real,
like Band of Brothers.
They're real people, and it follows their actual actions. You know, there are a couple probably, you know, creative liberties that are taken with having. There's, for example, there's certain scenes that 100% happened, but maybe they use one of the stars to do the thing that happens in that scene rather than somebody else.
It's not like Braveheart where it's just made up.
Right.
Yeah.
It's all historically accurate. And then at the end, there's a one-hour documentary that is done by, narrated by Hanks, produced by Hanks and Spielberg, and some of the guys that were still alive.
Yeah.
You actually got some. None of them are alive, I think, today, but were alive recently enough to be interviewed.
Yep.
Or that interviews at various times that are interspersed into it, like the real people. It was awesome. At the end of it, I was definitely weepish.
Yeah.
And I remember I said to Kayla, I said to Miss Kay, I was like, I'd like to think that if I was thrust into that position that I would have been able to do, you know, what these people
did. To be heroic.
But it is... I mean, that's the greatest generation for a reason. Like, the sacrifice, the commitment, what they went through is so powerful. And I think it's a very cool thing to see. And one of the guys they interview in the end of the documentary basically says, like, you guys are all living these lives because of what we did and people before us did.
Yeah.
And so you need to know these stories.
Oh, it's
great. And I thought it was...
Yeah.
Spot on.
I think I told you I watched Band of Brother with NBC this summer.
Yeah.
And he was
enthralled
with
it. Unreal.
Like, just was like, really? And I'm like, yeah, your grandpa was not in the 101st Airborne, but he was in Germany, he was in France. And so, like, that, yeah, like, they're the greatest generation. But you don't really have a choice, do you? Like, this is a true world war. It's the worst evil of all time is on the other side of the globe, and it's growing, and we've got to go do something about it.
Yeah.
And then Pearl Harbor happens, and away we go.
It really wasn't, though, till the introduction of the P-51 Mustang.
Mm-hmm.
That the P-51 Mustang, you could look back and say, won the war because it wiped out the Luftwaffe, the German Air Force, completely. Like, there was a six-month period where the death rate for German pilots was 99%.
Jeez, you fly, you die.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then that's how on D-Day, for example, when we flew on D-Day, there was not a single German plane in the sky.
Yeah.
That's how quickly they had taken them out with the P-51s.
Yeah. I'm looking forward to it.
It's powerful. It's awesome. Then, like, for example, there's one guy, Rosenthal's his last name, was a pilot. He flew... If you made it 25 missions, you got to go home.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, nope. I'm sticking. Ends up flying 52, which is the most of anybody in that division. There's one mission where he's the only plane that comes back. He was unreal. And then he ends up getting shot down. They all get shot down at some point. And the Russians get him, thank goodness. And when he's going, he ended up seeing the remains of a concentration camp.
Yeah.
Which really was very, obviously, powerful to him and made him very angry. So that's why he came back for even more.
Yeah.
And then at the end, he actually ended up being a prosecutor in the Nuremberg trials.
Jeez.
So, like, you're talking about
life of consequence.
Yeah. So powerful stuff.
I can't wait to watch
it. So good stuff.
I'm hoping I'm able to.
Highly recommended.
And yeah, that's, those are all absolutely absurdly good. We couldn't recommend all of those enough. They're as good as gets. Let's get into your hot topics today, presented by Vivid Seats, official fan experience partner your Cleveland Browns. Mary Kay reporting that Deshaun Watson could begin light throwing as early as today. His private quarterback coach Quincy Avery and David Njoku flew out to LA Monday to be part of the process at UCLA.
How about it? I think it's going to be great. Chiefs out there. I like that. Start throwing today is the day that everybody said he's going to start throwing. So I think that's huge. It's huge for the Browns. Obviously, we've talked about many, many times that this season is all about, you know, the quarterback, Deshaun Watson, and getting him to play at the level that we believe he's capable of playing
yep.
and that we saw glimpses of certainly last year. He's excited about Ken Dorsey and what this offense is going to look like. Now he's got the chief out there, and he'd love to see that, see your stars go out there.
Yeah.
Then we heard Nyheim Hines yesterday say he was actually rehabbing with the same doctor, and so he's become friends with Deshaun as well, being out there with him. So, yeah, that's great news, great news.
Yeah, very much so. Last summer we had the quarterback. This summer we're going to have the wide receiver. So they followed quarterbacks last year on Netflix's series, The Quarterback. It's pretty good. It was Cousins and Mahomes, and then Mariota. Yeah, but he's pretty forgettable. Whatever.
He's back. He's somebody.
I'm not sure
him.
I can't remember if I finished The Quarterback. I watched.
Yeah, you did, for sure.
Well, what happened to Mariota? Did he just disappear off?
He just disappeared off show because he left the Falcons.
Okay, that's why.
Because so kind of like
because he just kind of evaporated.
Yeah, basically. They touch on it. He talks one time about it. I wouldn't handle it any differently. And it was like, that's it.
And that's it. And then it ended up being Cousins and Mahomes the rest of the way. So they got a pretty good class here. Devontae Adams, Justin Jefferson, George Kittle, Deebo Samuel, Amon-Ra St. Brown.
Well, you're going to get receivers. Frustration at various points from Adams. You're going to get Jefferson dealing with the first significant injury of his career and then losing Kirk Cousins. Kittle and Deebo, I think, will be awesome. And then Amon-Ra St. Brown will be
That one's going to be
awesome.
Magical, the St. Brown part of it. I mean, the magical season in Detroit, reliving that through his eyes, and he was an all-pro. Like,
yeah,
that's pretty crazy.
Yeah, he's awesome.
Yeah. I think this is really cool. Would you have ever guessed that this was Peyton Manning's path, that he would be a content creator?
So, if you remember his Hall of Fame induction speech, he didn't necessarily say, I'm going to be a content creator, but he said something to the effect of, how important it is to tell the stories of the great players, and so I think that's what he's doing.
Yeah, he's done that with Peyton's places. He's done it now with this. He did it with he's doing it with Eli and the Peyton and Eli thing. He's crossed that over, and he does Vince's places. There's a Sue Bird does one.
Yeah,
there's a hockey one with PK Subban. Like, there's all of those things that they're doing, but it's. I guess we all assumed, and forever it was rumored, even towards the end of his playing career, that he was going to get into an ownership group and that he was going to go run an NFL team.
Yeah.
And he just doesn't have an interest in doing
this
that.
This feels a lot. This feels pretty good for him.
It feels very good.
Yeah. This feels pretty good.
I'm sure this is much more entertaining, far less pressure, far more present with your family.
And plenty lucrative. Not.
Oh, gosh, yeah.
But I mean, plenty lucrative.
Yes, quite. And he's made about as much as can be made. So, yeah, he benefits in every single way.
I wish Amari was in this.
Would have been a good one to get him.
Because I think I would be so curious to see, for people to get to see his work ethic and his just commitment to his craft, and then see how that compares to some of these other guys on here. Like, that's what stood out to me was Cousins. You came out of there with zero doubt that Kirk Cousins gets everything out of his being that is possible.
Yes.
And then that Mahomes has more talent and is also committed to get everything out of his being, which was really impressive. Why are people going at Cousins so much? Because he's won one playoff game in 12 years. I guess that is really what you're supposed to do as a quarterback. But
I think because he's gotten paid like he's a top five quarterback in the league. What do you get jealous about most in life? It's usually money or what someone has. I mean, and that you don't. And Cousins has made an absurd amount of money, top five quarterback in the league money, without delivering top five quarterback in the NFL results.
There's somebody I'm jealous of.
Well, there was a range that he had. I mean, there was a...
Well, it was more just his catalog of...
But also, there was a certain skill set with his range.
Which was fun.
It was very good, yeah. I mean, I would think that was... I think there's a movie coming.
Love it. Love
about
to see
that.
It.
Or no, it was the other one.
Well, if you're talking about the one that went south. Oh, yeah, sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
All right, so what was they saying? Oh, Cousins. Were you surprised that he got 18, that he didn't get 8 from Pitts? Did you see this?
So he's going with
18. He's going with 18. So he went to, they were going to do a negotiation.
Pitts said he would give it to him.
I guess.
He just wanted targets.
I guess not. He's wearing 18. So how do you blow that negotiation? How does that not work?
Maybe he doesn't want to give Pitts targets.
Maybe he didn't like that Pitts asked for targets.
I don't know.
It's weird though, right? Like, he was having fun in the presser, like he was going to wear 8, and then the Falcons had it out there yesterday. He's wearing 18.
Maybe he wants a new beginning.
Maybe. What?
See, our boy Tak is wearing 16 in New England. That's what he wore in high school and college. 16.
Yeah, I like that.
I didn't know linebackers could wear 16.
Well, you can wear anything. JOK wears six.
Right. I thought single, I guess, but you don't see a lot of.
Isn't Micah Parsons 11?
Micah Parsons is 11. That's a good point.
So I think you can wear, once they did the rule where you can wear anything, but it's not any position because, like, defensive ends can't.
Can't.
So, like, you have to be, those guys, those defensive ends who wear singles, they have to be qualified as outside linebackers, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's the operation there on that side of things. All right. So there you go. Quinton Jefferson, he's right there.
All right.
He's going to join us coming up next. We're off and running. By the way, those are your hot topics presented by Vivid Seats, official fan experience partner of your Cleveland Browns. You'll listen to Cleveland Browns Daily on 850 ESPN Cleveland.
An accent.
And Bo here for my great friends at James B. Beam Distilling Company. Booker Noe's vision for Knob Creek was to be the embodiment of full-flavored American whiskey through age-proof and flavor to create a product that sets the standard. Knob Creek is created to champion those who stay true to their craft, know what they like, and don't feel the pressure to conform. Now through April 30th, and don't forget about this one, take advantage of the Knob Creek steak rebate. So here's how it works. You get a rebate when you buy a Knob Creek bourbon plus a steak. Upload a picture. It's all you got to do. You get the receipts to knobcreeksteakrebate.com. They're going to send you $20 right to your Venmo account. Must be 21 to participate. See full terms at knobcreeksteakrebate.com. Knob Creek, Kentucky Straight Bourbon Whiskey, 50% alcohol by volume. 2024, James B. Beam Distilling Company, Claremont, Kentucky. Knob Creek, drink what tastes right. It feels right to have Quinton Jefferson in the studio with us.
Yeah, it does.
Good to see you.
Thanks
to see you. We were talking off air. The process is always, we're always fascinated with that from a free agent position. Mm-hmm. How did this come about? How did you end up a Cleveland Brown? How excited are you to be here and to be in the room with the best defense in football last year?
How it came about, you know, it's just the craziness of football. Like, if you would have asked me at the beginning of free agency, would I be in Cleveland? I'd probably be like, no, I'd probably be back with the Jets. But, you know, things happen, and I think I'm where I'm supposed to be. And like you said before, and I just knowing I had the opportunity to come join an already great defensive line, like, I couldn't pass up that opportunity. You know, I'm excited to get with those guys, get in that room, and get after it this year. You know, they put up some great numbers last year, so I was like, man, let's top that.
Is it nice to know that you'll never be double-teamed?
Oh, that's lovely. that's lovely.
I'm like, pretty much a lock.
Everybody slide the miles. Like, let me get all the one-on-ones. No, but I'm excited, you know, to especially play with a player of his caliber, you know, future Hall of Famer. And, yeah, I'm excited to see him just in person, see him work and pick his brain about things and just ultimately go play with him.
For people who don't know, you're an incredibly productive player. You can rush the quarterback. And when you can do that, you can play in this league for a very long time.
Yes, sir.
You've done it so effectively that every year a new team wants you. They're like, no, you're going to come play with us now. 6 sacks last year, career high. You got 16 total the last 3 seasons. You got at least 13 quarterback hits in 3 straight seasons. What is it about you that allows you to get to the quarterback? What do you kind of hang your hat on as a pass rusher?
First, I think my parents giving me this God-given ability.
Right? Good genes, that helps?
I was fortunate even to come in the league just having great guys to look up to. You know, my first year I was with Michael Bennett, who I literally like modeled my game after, and still to this day he coaches me up, and Cliff Averill. And just getting my hands, they got my hands good and just my knowledge of the game. And, just year in, year out, I was fortunate to play with great players. And I tried to just take away something of everybody's game, you know, and just always trying to just learn and build. And just I love competing, you know. So every year I just come out with a new attitude, new mind, just trying to compete and make myself better. Even this year, like, I think last year was a good season, but I want to be even better than I was last year. Just been blessed with just having the mindset, competitive edge, and just it's worked out.
You know, it's interesting when you have the choice to go wherever you want, and you went through this process, and you said, well, probably would have thought I wouldn't end up back with the Jets. When it became obvious that Cleveland was interested, what type of work do you do then to make sure it's a fit? How close do you look at what Jim Schwartz does defensively, the guys in the room? Because obviously you want to play, you want to have impact, 6 sacks last year.
Yeah,
let's get 7 next year. Like, what do you look at? What's that checklist look like?
Definitely scheme. Scheme is the biggest thing. And, you know, coming into the league, I was used in a handful of ways. I played probably every position across the D-line. But just knowing what that coordinator's vision is for you and definitely aligned. I don't know if you guys know, I came here last year on a visit. And honestly, it was between here and the Jets. End up going to New York, but, you know, everything works itself out. And, I mean, I'm back here. And you know,
so clearly they've had their eye on you for a while.
Yeah, you know, so that's good. It worked out how it's supposed to. And like I said, like Schwartz, I know he's going to put me in a great situation. His defense, the D-line always eats. You know, I feel like I'm best utilized when I could get off the ball, create havoc.
That's what they're going to tell you to do.
Yeah.
Yes, you're not catching. You're going.
Yeah, go. And even Jock, we have familiarity. He was with me in the Bills, and I know he's going to, again, put me in the best position to be successful. So it just, yeah, it worked out.
You're with Shelby in Seattle, right?
Yeah.
Have you talked to Shelby at all?
No, I still got to holler at him, man. Yeah. Shelby, he's a funny dude,
last week. He re-signed, a hilarious guy.
Yeah,
good
so I'm
player.
Looking forward to getting in the locker room and joke him some more.
Yeah.
That's going to be fun.
It's a very good, I would say, and a very veteran room. Like, yeah. You'll have yourself, Shelby, Maurice Hurst, who's been in the league for a while, Dalvin Tomlinson.
Yeah.
And then in the edge, you know, Miles and Zadarius have been around for a while, Oboka Ronco. So it's a good – it's a good mix. It's a tight room.
Yeah.
I think you guys are going to have a lot of fun. Do you care 4-3-3-4? Is that something? Because I'm sure you've been in all of it throughout your career. But yeah, this will be more similar, I imagine, just what Salah was having
yeah.
to
do.
Maybe not up front.
I used to say, like, oh, it really doesn't matter. But it, being a little older, I think it does matter. I definitely prefer to be in a 4-3 scheme. You know, I think 4-3 schemes do showcase D-line more. 3-4, I feel like what you're asked is – kind of hold up blocks and be like a bigger build guy. And like when I went back to Seattle doing it again, I was like, yeah, this ain't for me.
Yeah.
I'd rather use my athleticism. I'm at my best going this way, not reading and holding guys up.
So one thing you were used to that'll be similar to last year was you had a very good secondary behind you.
Yeah.
You know, with Sauce and Reed, and you knew that at times they were going to have to hold the ball.
Yeah, got a pat.
That lets you get there. So, you know, Denzel, MJ Emerson, Greg Newsome, we've got good safeties as well. and we get people in third and long a lot. So that's, I imagine, music to your ears. But how important is it, you know, when you're thinking of it as a defensive lineman, when you know that the guys behind you can cover, how much easier does that make your job or change your mindset?
It makes it kind of easier, but honestly, I would say it kind of makes it harder because I know if they complete a pass, it's on us, especially in third and long. So it's like I have to have an even more heightened sense of urgency because I know, like, man, he pat the ball. We got to get home. We got to get home. So everybody has to raise their sense of urgency, you know. So you got to act like your hair's on fire. So, yeah, knowing that, I just want to do my part. I'm like, I don't want my brothers out there covering all day. So I'm like, we get a pat. We got to get the quarterback down.
I like that.
Yeah, there's just a
– get a pat, get a sack.
I'm looking at these places you've been. Probably the most similar from a rabid fan base is probably Buffalo is probably a similar. Yeah. And this is – man, this is a hungry town. It's a hungry team. It's a hungry division. Like, yeah. I mean, this is going to be a lot of fun, but this is a snake pit of a division.
Yeah.
When you look and how much have you paid attention to all of the teams in the North, what you are signing up for on a week-in, week-out basis playing in it?
Oh, yeah. You know, I'm from Pittsburgh, so I grew up watching this division, even over the years how it's evolved to now. Yeah, it's probably the most competitive division in football right now. You know, and I'm excited. I mean, I think that just raised my level of play. I know there's no off days. You got to come week in, week out, ready to deliver. And not only just – it's the brand of football. It's physical, you know. And I know, yeah, I have to have the right mindset. Come, again, with my mind right week in, week out to get physical, get dirty. And I'm excited.
I feel like Russ is going to be sad that you're in the division.
No doubt. That's my boy, man. I'm glad Russ, he had a good situation, good opportunity now, but definitely he's going down when we play.
Good. I like it. So this is obviously exciting for you. Family, you got four kids, three girls, twins, so you're outnumbered all the time at home.
Yeah.
Yeah. How has that been? And have they Cleveland?
I think they don't know even what to expect because I don't know if we ever been to Ohio or Cleveland in general. But, you know, they're always excited up for a new adventure, new opportunity. And, those are my babies. They keep me going. They're the reason why I do the things I do, the reason why I push my body the way I do in order to provide a good life for them and for to be, a role model for them. You know, they see their dad get up, go to work every day. Like, we just got off a flight from Seattle. I'm back on the flight coming out here, you know, and at the end of the day, it's all worth it when I see the smile on their faces. So, I'm excited to get back to them after all this, you know. But, family is the reason why I do the things I do.
That's awesome. You know, Z went over, you know, how career high in sacks last year. We talked a little bit about fit and how those things work. For our fans who maybe aren't paying always attention to the defensive line, what are they going to get to cheer for in you?
Oh, man, you're going to see a dude comes out week in, week out, hard hat, work my tail off for my brothers. He's going to play every play like it's his last. I pride myself on playing hard every single play. I don't care if the ball is 50 yards down the field. I'm chasing, and who's going to get after the quarterback and get some sacks.
That'll work here.
I think that'll work very well, yeah. By the way, were you there? I can't remember everybody that was in the shot for the charcuterie board.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, I believe so.
Was that fun doing Hard Knocks?
Honestly, I didn't like it. It's a cool situation, but I didn't like it because it was just weird because, like I said, we'll be having a candid conversation like now.
Yeah.
And then you'll just see a mic just come over your head.
In the middle of it.
Yeah, and then I feel like you can't really be yourself. You know what I'm saying?
I'm sure, yeah.
But it was a cool experience, but I'm not even on social media or anything. I like just, yeah.
You like live and let your play do the talking.
Just, yeah,
for
live.
You. Exactly.
Was that mentalist guy, that's all real?
Yes.
Were you were in the room for that, right?
So when I was in Seattle, the same guy was there.
Oh, he did it there?
He did it there. And all I'm saying is both those years, I mean, it didn't come to fruition. So I don't know.
That's crazy.
I don't know.
Yeah. It's crazy. Some of the stuff he pulled off was wild. So you're saying some of the stuff didn't, so they edited so that some
Because, you know, at the end, like, the big reveal, like, oh, you're going to be playing in the Super Bowl.
Oh, right, it didn't come to fruition.
And I asked him, there was a movie. I don't want to reveal his, like, trick.
Yeah, no, but the first stuff was pretty good. Some stuff was pretty good.
Yeah. But it was a cool experience. I'll say that.
Yeah, I bet. We got to get him in here. I want to, and I want to be, we should be in there for that. I'd like to see that.
Maybe bring him in here.
Yeah, bring him right in here.
That's
right,
what it's all about. Yeah, good. That's it.
All right, I always ask the guys who joined the team this one, and you've covered quite a bit, so you may have covered it already with what you expect, bringing the hard hat, family, all of that. But what's something that you just want Browns fans, and like I said, not football-related, just something you want them to think about when they see Jefferson on the back of your jersey?
Family man. You know, that's what I pride myself on, being a dad, a husband, and, yeah, that's all I'm about, family.
I love it. Well, welcome to the Browns family.
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah, we're happy to have
good
you.
Good seeing you, man. Thank you for your time.
That.
Really
he's
gonna appreciate
it. Yeah. He's
going to
be feasting.
Yeah, it's going to be, gonna be a fun year. Fun. Yeah. Quinn Jefferson in studio. Thank you so much. You're listening to Cleveland Browns Daily on 850 ESPN Cleveland.
Well, you don't want to miss it. No, you made it. And hopefully you'll make it to Billy Joel and Rod Stewart. The first time, last time ever. One night only. September 13th. Cleveland Browns Stadium. You can buy tickets right now. They're readily available. ClevelandBrownsStadium.com/Billy and Rod.
Billy and Rod 2024.
It is Billy Joel. It's Rod Stewart. It's one night. One night only.
One night only.
Go ahead.
One night only. You know, I was out last night with the great Naish and G Dizio. And we were talking a little.
You come up, every once in a while, I think I know all of your social circle, and then I get new humans that I've never.
Naish and Dizio?
I don't think I've ever heard of Naish.
Naish is my buddy David Morris, the Mo Nation, I call him.
Yeah, so I don't Naish. Know Naish.
And then and you know G Diz. You know Dizio, Physio. Faux show.
Has it always been Dizio, or was there a previous?
G Diz.
That maybe makes some.
Dizio? Yeah. Right. We were out, and we talked a little Springsteen, Joel. They were both staunch Springsteeners for you. But then we were talking about Billy and Rod.
Yeah.
They're just like, how could you even think about missing this?
You can't.
Can't do it. And they're Springsteen people. They're like, you can't miss this, Billy and Rod.
Billy and Rod, yeah.
Billy and Rod, yeah.
Naish and Dizio, they both they agree.
Yeah.
With the reed.
Yeah.
They
can't miss
the
it.
Reed. You can't miss
you
it.
Can't miss it. Also, want to take a time out, look right in the camera, say happy birthday, George Mizanin.
Oh, Papa
George,
Miz.
George Mizanin, yep. Happy birthday to him today. What a human being.
What a human.
An absolute legend. I'm hoping to see him Friday at AIW. We got a show at Temple Live. Big show.
Oh, he's not loyal?
He's there for a lot of them, but I'm hoping he's going to be there. If he's going to be there for that one, then I'll get to embrace him.
Where are you at? What's the venue?
Temple Live, the Masonic Temple on the way to downtown.
There you go.
Temple Live, the Asylum Room, the AIW Asylum. It's going to be awesome. Big show. Very excited.
Very excited.
I'll be back. I'll be on the commentary table for a good portion of the proceedings.
Why just a good portion?
They've got a guy who's been doing it the whole time, so I don't want to I'm back, here so comes, you can't do
yeah,
it.
Yeah, but like on Saturday night's main event, when the body showed
they
up.
They joke. I still do. They call it, I work like the John Cena. I just come in and do, I always do the main event. So yeah. I'll do the main event.
Because as a kid on Saturday night's main event, the body wasn't always there.
No, but when he
but
was.
When he was there.
A match of
consequence. I know that we got a lot going on, that you're going to have some chaos.
The tough part is, like, all the guys on the show are, like, my guys now.
Yeah.
So I want to do all their matches because then I can, you know, give them some love. But there's too much, and I got to, you know, I can only do
some. You have jobs. You ever
I'm doing,
get
I'm doing five,
family and
I'm doing
jobs
five or? Of the nine. I'm doing all three title matches. I'm doing my boy Bishop's match. What else am I doing?
I'm not fighting. I won't be there.
No. He could be it'd be a great cousin for you to have. Joshua Bishop, 25. Looks like
that'd be perfect.
Looks
I could
like
be
Sid Vicious.
I could be like an Eric Bischoff type and manage him.
You'd be great.
I'd be good at that.
Killer Bees.
Yeah. Kind of an interesting gimmick.
What?
Remember, there were the Killer Bees. The
jumping,
tag team.
Jumping Jim Brunzel.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. Brian Blair, right?
Yeah, that's right.
And Jumping Jim Brunzel.
Yeah. Hey, did you see a couple of notes around the league here as we close out the first hour here? Did you see Cal McNair just said, you want me to just show you the uniforms?
And they did.
He did. He tweeted it out.
For what they have to work with, and all I saw was the one image of
there's
Tank,
only one out there.
Tank
there's,
Dell.
There's a white jersey over a blue pant.
It looks good. It's better. I like the font. I think the font they use invokes steers to me, so I think that's
good. They have like a horn thing here. They always do the
and the
Nike
the
always
number,
got a special font, which sometimes it hits or misses.
Yeah,
it's not that different.
Not that different, but I think it's good. I just think they should be running whatever their text and stuff is in the Oilers colors, and that would be fine. That'd be beautiful.
Yeah, so I think it seems like they're going to have a battle red helmet. Like
yes,
the one
they
wore
have.
This year.
Yep.
So they're going to have a red over red with white pant, and then there will be a light blue version as well. So
that needs a white lid.
That's exactly where I was going. That needs to have a white lid, but I don't know, can we have three lids?
Yeah, I think you could. I think you're
now you can have as many lids as you want.
I think you're limitless on your lids.
Oh, okay. For some reason, I thought you could have like one alternate lid in the NFL.
I think like the Broncos have three that are coming up because they have.
So maybe that's a new thing where now you can have as many lids as you want.
Yeah. So I'm pretty sure they have a white, they have their navy blue, and they have that baby blue of the old.
Like what color blue is that? That blue.
It's beautiful.
Yeah.
Carl Mecklenburg.
Yeah. I don't know what that color is, though. It's like a the kind of a true, it's a lighter blue, but it's not, it's not baby blue.
No.
It's not like Carolina blue, or it's kind of closer to maybe UCLA blue.
Yeah. It's got a little warmth to it.
UCLA blue is even two different shades of blue, though, because their football uniforms are very sky blue.
Yes.
And then the blue on their basketball is more of a true blue.
And their gear.
And their gear. Yeah. So I don't understand that part of it. So the biggest difference I could tell is they just, instead of red numbers, they're blue. A little bit different font.
And the font is different.
And the stripe, they don't have that stripe here, the red stripe here.
No, it's more of like a horn thing across, which is cool.
And the blue looked a little deeper to me, but maybe it's the same.
Yeah. It's hard to say. It's one photo.
It is. It's very hard to say. So they got them. They got new uniforms this year, and then the Broncos are getting new uniforms this year. Is there anybody else we're missing?
I don't know.
Oh, Jets.
What?
No, they're gonna. I think they're gonna wear the Sack Exchange ones. They're doing a home and away of that. Like that's gonna be the
and that's
the thing.
They'll have an all black.
Oh, I think
it, I bet.
But I think it's a Sack Exchange
black.
Look, all in that template.
Good. That's a good.
Get rid of this.
By the way, some of these things were nailed in earlier times. Just run with it, Mr. Dorsey.
Well, the Jets part of it is I mean they have two great lineages. They could go Namath, which those are perfect.
Yeah.
Or they could go the 80s. Both of those are good.
Chad Pennington, Santana Mosses.
Yeah, which was kind of a darker green version of the Namaths. The Namaths were more of a Kelly.
Yeah.
But, yeah.
No, they have plenty of good stuff. When they went to their absurd, those were terrible, Kenny. Didn't need to do that. By the way, I really enjoyed Quinton Jefferson. It's great.
A lot to like.
Yeah, a lot to like. And let me tell you something.
A lot of personality with that guy. He's a good player.
He can get to the quarterback. That is.
I didn't realize he started 14 games last year for the Jets.
Yeah.
Or that he had a career high with 6 sacks.
Yeah. Here's the craziest thing. This is going to be his 6th different team in 6 years. And yet he's had at least 3 sacks from the interior every season he's ever been in the league. But he went 19 with Seattle, 3.5 sacks, 20 Buffalo, 3 sacks, 21 Vegas, 4.5 sacks, 22 Seattle, 5.5 sacks, and this year 6. So his sacks have increased 3 straight seasons, which means he's due to have at least 8.
There you go. Couple other signings, the Saints giving Chase Young a fully guaranteed one-year deal worth $13 million. I just can't believe how poorly his career's gone.
So
it's like a Clowney situation where he can't, and I don't even know if he's ever been as
Clowney's
good as Clowney was.
Clowney's at least was considered to be the best run defending.
Yeah,
end,
like Chase just never.
Was a Pro Bowler.
There was never been a point where he got hurt early
so
and then,
this
I don't
is,
know.
This is boots on the ground, not Pedro.
Oh, God. So by the way,
they didn't like his work ethic. They didn't like his
with
commitment.
I will say with
they
everything
didn't like
with
the way he played the run, like took plays completely off.
Yeah, careful with the Pedro stuff.
They didn't like him.
I got boots on the ground on the Iditarod. A woman was not involved.
Well, we both know that to be true. Yep. Yes,
so be careful.
Well, this here's the difference. He was not at the Iditarod.
Oh, so these are his
boots on
his
the ground.
Boots on his own boots
his
on
own
the
boots.
Ground. Yeah,
yeah. This is where he is.
Yeah.
I assure you that there are very few people who consume more 49ers content on this planet
than
my father.
Was it that way always? Like when you were a kid,
loved
was it always?
Sports, yeah, we
see was it
the
always
Sporting
Niners?
Green. He would sit on his chair. He'd read the Sporting Green. It used to be a green section of the newspaper.
Oh, really?
Yeah, it was called the Sporting Green. It was green. The movie
the Chronicle,
section was,
or were you
yeah,
a,
the San Francisco Chronicle? Yeah,
yeah.
Of course. And the movie section was always pink. The entertainment section.
Was it really?
Pink.
Like the paper,
the
itself,
paper itself
was
green
pink.
Yeah,
and
green.
Pink.
It's called the Sporting Green.
That's pretty wild.
Yeah.
I didn't know
so
the
you could look
that.
Right through the fold and you'd be
pull what you want.
Pull the green.
So the whole newspaper was a green tint or just
no,
that
the
lit?
Whole newspaper was normal.
Oh,
and
just
then
the top.
When you folded it in the different sections, there was a green section, which was sports, you could just pull right out, or a pink
oh,
section.
Yeah, yeah.
That was entertainment.
I do remember that. Yeah. Yeah. How that went.
And they had like a movie rating system that I loved. It was like a little cartoon dude. And if he was like, if his chair was empty, he walked out of the theater. He hated it. If he was like asleep, bored him. Then if like there was like sitting up, like yeah, okay, edge of his seat, good, and then he was out of his seat clapping.
That was great.
That was their movie rating.
That's
system.
Great.
It was great.
Yeah. Now it was this different time, man.
Chase
I'm
Young
to explain that to everybody, but yeah, he's
career high
tight.
Is 7.5 sacks.
Yeah, it's crazy, and he was just so dominant, and he was following the Boses at Ohio State. Both of those guys have been stars. Nick's been defensive player of the year, and the thinking was that, I mean, down there they
and
felt
Joey's
like
been
great
very good.
And
made
he's been great
a
yeah.
ton of money.
The feeling down there was that he was
better, right?
But the better prospect. I don't know that at times he was even more productive. Like if he doesn't get suspended,
his junior year at Ohio State for, like, what did he give his girlfriend, tickets or something like that? Some nonsense. If he didn't do that, like, there was a chance, like, he was at the top of the Heisman conversation.
Yeah, yeah.
That year at Ohio State. But it just, I don't know, if it came too quick, I don't know what happened. He got hurt in Washington almost right away.
Well, you don't want that to happen.
No, and that was it. Josh Dobbs headed to the 49ers on a one-year deal, our old buddy. That's good to see. Isn't it crazy, like, everything that's happened? Because it was a little more than a year ago where he almost was impaled. Wasn't he the one who almost got hit at the golf tournament?
No, that was A.J. Green.
Oh, it was A.J. Green. Josh was interviewing with us.
Was with us.
He was with us. We were that's right. We're interviewing Josh while A.J. Green was almost ended.
There is no doubt in my mind that would have caused him serious damage.
I think it would have been an ambulance situation,
yes,
for sure.
If it hit him in the face, 100%.
If it hit him in certain parts of the skull, 1,000,000,000%.
Very bad. Yeah. Chest, I feel like, would have been.
Could have been not great.
Rib would have been broken.
Broken a rib for sure. Yeah. It was a screaming eagle, 4 feet off the ground.
It was a golf ball going over 100 miles an hour.
Yeah.
Right at him.
Right at him. And he had no idea. They drove right by.
Dented that.
Yep.
Metal side, which is it's a small piece of metal, so it doesn't have a lot of softness in the middle.
Yeah. So I remember we were interviewing him.
Yeah.
Former Brown and Ravens guard Kevin Zeitler goes to the Lions on a deal.
Lions are loading up, and they already have an excellent offensive line. And by the way, the Ravens are the one team in our division that I don't think has gotten better.
Yeah, you mentioned that yesterday, and I think you're right. They just had too many
losses.
Yeah, and all their staff defensively.
All of it. But that's a big loss on their offensive line. Zeitler, never a Pro Bowler, always just considered rock solid. I mean, we had him here. He was rock solid.
Yes. Former Cowboys first-round pick Leighton Vander Esch announces his retirement after 6 seasons in the NFL. Short career, sad. But
says body just couldn't do it.
Can't do it. If you want to do this Clemson thing, why don't you ask me the questions and I'll answer them.
Clemson University has filed against the ACC, making them the second team in the conference to do so. They have filed what, Bo Bishop?
They filed a lawsuit against the ACC.
Why?
The idea here is to get out. The ACC has a grant of rights deal with its member institutions that lasts until 2036 that will pay them a static rate of around $30 million a year from now until 2036. It is non-binding. You cannot get out. Many have tried. Florida State's already suing. That's why Clemson's the second team. They want out because in their own states, teams are going to start to make $90 million a year. So if you're Florida State and you're Clemson and you play in the same state as the University of Florida and the University of South Carolina, and they're going to get $90 million a year from the SEC package and you're going to get $30 million a year from the ACC package, you cannot keep up. Can't. $60 million a year, you can't make that up. So it's the second one. They're joining the lawsuit by Florida State. Florida State tried doing this about a year ago. They get nowhere. I think the only way that anything can come of this is if – a majority of the ACC teams that are under this grant of rights all sue to get out. That's really it.
Can they leave the ACC?
No.
So
they can, but the ACC owns their television rights until 2036.
Even if they go into the SEC.
So they go into the SEC, which the SEC doesn't want them. But
SEC wouldn't want Clemson or Florida State?
No, they're already in those markets. They don't need to split the pie more. The SEC's got a $90 million package with 16 teams.
Well, what happened to our idea? What about our idea, your idea, of two 32-team leagues?
Well, that might happen at some point.
Yeah.
But right now, it would not be financially beneficial for the Southeastern Conference to add more teams in their own region.
Okay.
They would just – the individual teams that are already in it would just lose their share. So it's not going to happen right now.
Okay.
But that's what's going on in that crazy sport. Okay. All right. We've got a Daniel Jeremiah mock draft. We've got a fun Griff fact of the day.
Oh,
we've
baby.
Got a little thing or not a thing. You're listening to Cleveland Browns Daily on 850 ESPN Cleveland.
Hey, did you know the Rolling Stones Hackney Diamonds Tour is Saturday, June 15th, Cleveland Browns Stadium? Tickets are on sale now. Visit ClevelandBrownsStadium.com/Rolling Stones for more information. Do you think you would know more combined Rolling Stones songs or Billy Joel and Rod Stewart songs?
It's a good question.
That's a great question.
Thank you. This is 2 weeks in a row that I've given you people some great ones.
I think probably Stones.
My hunch is Stones, but I don't know how many Stone songs would I know like all the words to.
Correct.
Like that might be as few as like 5 or 6.
Yeah, but I know like a billion Stone songs.
I think I do.
And I think I know a lot of Billy Joel. I just don't.
I think you know more Rod Stewart, and The Voice was adamant about this. You know more Rod Stewart than you think.
Maybe, but I don't think like right now, I don't think I can name even one song by Rod Stewart.
Did he do like Maggie May? Forever Young? I think he did some of those.
Forever Young?
Didn't he sing that? I don't know.
Yes.
He sang so. Forever Young?
Pretty
sure. Sounds like that guy, like Walking in Memphis guy to me.
I don't know. That's,
boy, that's Mark
Cohen.
Mark Cohen. That's a song in the South that goes.
Oh, man. It's a great song.
Yeah, when that shows up at a bar, the people go nuts down there.
Walking with my feet.
It's a great song. One hit, though, for that guy.
Forever Young is Rod Stewart.
There you
all right,
go.
So I know that.
So I think you're going to know more.
I don't know Maggie May. Like,
you would if you heard it. I promise
I couldn't
you.
Even give you a chorus.
I guarantee
I know
you.
Forever Young.
Have I told you lately that I love you?
Yeah, there's. Yeah,
like, that's not Lionel Richie.
Ballad.
I think you'd know Maggie May.
The Motown song?
No, don't
good,
know it.
Good tune.
Don't know it. This is why I need to go, maybe.
Well, you
Downtown
can.
Downtown Train?
Good, yeah, there's no, good
one. Don't know that one.
Some guys have all the luck.
Some guys
there you
have
go.
Yeah,
all
see,
the luck. I think you
there's
know
more
than
you
think.
Know.
All right, I'm trying to pull up Maggie. Oh, we don't need to do that live on the air. I think you'd know Maggie May.
Okay. All right. Yeah, maybe in the commercial break.
My hunch is it's Stones, but it might be. Oh, here. Is this it?
Yes. I pulled it up on this side.
So if you have to say, is this it?
No, you'll know the chorus. Okay. So I can't remember that this is how it started.
Billy and Rod 2024.
Sounds like a Irish.
This honestly.
Bard's Tale. It sounds to be like a
like
medieval
a
movie.
This could easily be like the lead into Bullock and Swearingen getting into something in Deadwood.
I could see that. Or it could be
but
King
it's
Arthur
pick up.
And the Knights of the Round Table.
This thing seems more. Yeah.
Still nothing. Complete blank.
It's all
space.
Instrumental at this point.
I'm a complete blank.
How long does it take him to start singing, for God's sakes? We're like 45 seconds into this. Wake up, Maggie. I think I got something. You know that. You've
yeah,
heard
I
that.
Think I've heard that. Yeah. Wake up, Maggie.
Yeah.
Yes.
All right. Very good job. Very good job. Thank you for that. It was a good job.
Does he sing something like, I don't know the words, but like, your heart. Dun, dun,
I don't know.
Dun, dun.
Sure.
You know that song?
Which one?
Your heart. Dun, dun.
Your heart. Dun, 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 dun.
I don't know.
Oh,
I
know that either.
Yeah, I know. I know. Actually,
your,
I do know.
It
what
might
you're
be
talking
your heart
about.
Beats
tonight or something. Yeah, I know what
your heart beats.
See, we know. So the voice is right.
So we're at like 7 or 8.
If you're at 7 or 8 rods, you definitely owe
Billy and Rod 2020.
Definitely owe no 7 or 8 Billy Joel's.
One night only for way more.
Way more than that. So then
a bottle of reds.
I didn't know we were going to get a concert.
I mean, we could. We could do that.
Here's the deal, though, with all due respect to Billy and Rod.
Jade McRae says, yes, Young Hearts is what it's called.
Good job, Jade. Here's the deal. If the opening couple of chord flicks of Paint It Black, then that's the whole operation. That would be it. Like, if that's a top five favorite song for me ever,
period.
Full stop.
I so like Get No Satisfaction, Jumpin' Jack Flash.
We know a lot of them.
Gimme Shelter.
Thing, like the first couple notes of that one.
Scorsese
like,
put
right,
Gimme Shelter in Goodfellas, Departed, all of them.
Like, Beast of Burden.
Satisfaction's in Apocalypse Now.
You can't always get what you want.
Paint It Black's in Apocalypse Now, too.
So I can't get no satisfaction because Larry Fishburne is jamming out to it, holding a machine gun on the back of the boat.
Yeah.
Build as Larry.
Brown Sugar.
Yeah, there's a lot. There's a lot. I think it's still Stones.
Yes.
It's still Stones.
Yes.
Start Me Up.
Yeah.
Start Me Up. That reminds me of the late 80s Oakland Athletics.
God, what a squad.
So good. Sad that they're not even – they don't exist anymore.
They do for right now, right? They're still finishing out in Oakland, playing out the
street. What, one more year?
I don't know. I don't know. Where are you going to go?
Vegas rejected him, though, right?
No. That was the city of Vegas, the mayor of Las Vegas. But remember, I thought I went through this. The mayor of Vegas said she didn't want it, but she doesn't control it. It's the county that controls the strip.
Yep.
So she's got no say. So they're gonna go there.
By the way, what a musician Jade is, that from my not even really knowing the words and just going.
She's elite in every way.
Yeah, that's right.
That's the
follow her YouTube channel.
Yeah, do it.
Do it.
Do it.
Do it.
Do it.
Do it.
Do it. Underrated movie. Very funny.
You guys know what movie that's from?
No, they don't. Sorry. Do they even know what that is? They might not even know what it is, even by me saying. Uno, have you ever seen Starsky and Hutch?
No.
Ben Stiller.
See, that's how old we are.
Ben Stiller, Owen Wilson, Snoop, and The Rock.
In all fairness.
Vaughn.
Yeah. Vaughn. Huggy Bear.
I've seen the original show.
Yeah, the original show's great. The Torino.
Yeah.
But the movie's fantastic.
Who's Vaughn in it?
He's the big bad.
In
all fairness, you can never Snoop's ask Huggy Uno Bear, about right? movies because he's Snoop's, never seen anything.
Snoop's Huggy Bear.
The Rock's in it.
Yeah. And then you've got, and then Wilson and Stiller. Yeah.
Do it.
Do it. Yeah. Very good. All right. Let's do a little thing or not a thing, shall we, Gibby?
Sure. The 2024 NFL Free Agent Matchmaker by Cody Benjamin. These are the good top remaining free agents and what he considers to be the best fits for them. I will ask you guys thing or not a thing.
All right.
First and foremost, Ryan Tannehill to the Broncos. Could that be a thing or not a thing? Bishop.
What are you trying to do with Sean Payton? Like, you're not trying to win.
You have to win some games.
You're probably trying to punt and make sure you're picking high, but it's, you know, I'm sure someone will talk themselves into Quinn Ewers, although there has been talk that next year a quarterback might not go one. So, who knows? Usually they end up finding a couple that go one, but we'll see. I don't know what Sean Payton's doing. I really don't. I don't understand it. I mean, they're burning it all down to, I guess, build it back up is the hope that you can see through it. But
yep. I don't know.
I don't know. It's kind of weird.
It feels like it'd be a thing. I mean, it feels like he could be like, all right, you can do kind of some of what Drew Brees did for me.
Yeah, I just don't know. Like, is
good guy?
Is Tannehill? Yeah, because you want people to play hard. You want them to believe in what you're doing. You want to win, but not much.
Tannehill can do that.
He can do that. Yeah. Okay. Thing.
Yeah.
Up next on Thing or Not a Thing, Carson Wentz to the Chiefs. Kansas City needs a backup QB after Blaine Gabbert hit the market. The Chiefs reportedly sniffed around the ex-Eagles star a year ago. Zagura, thing or not a thing?
I hope not.
I'm totally in. That guy sucks.
I hope not. I don't know. He just – everything you hear about him is that he just, like, rubs a lot of people the wrong way. So, I don't think you need to introduce that into – he's not, like, so good you have
Let's
to have
introduce
him.
It. Let's go. Let's so get some weaknesses going.
He's
going
to be their instrument of chaos?
Yeah.
I think it would be a thing for Carson Wentz to go there under Andy Reid to try to resurrect his career. I think it's irrelevant who the backup is in Kansas City. Because if Mahomes were ever to go down, it's done. So, it doesn't really matter.
Although, I guess it would depend on what McVay said about him last year, right? Didn't he come in and play for the Rams?
Yeah.
I mean, I know that they hated him in Washington. Oh, boy.
Yeah.
That crowd.
Not a fan. No.
No.
Up next, guys, on Thing or Not a Thing, Mike Williams, free agent wide receiver. He's visiting three teams this week. Uno, I don't remember which teams. I know the Squealers are one of them.
Steelers are getting the last visit, right? Isn't that the deal?
The Jets and someone else. But
the
he
Panthers.
Says,
Panthers.
Mike Williams to the Cardinals.
Yes, thing. I
thing,
like that.
Go there.
Do it.
Please.
Be a great place
Scarlett,
for you.
Scarlett, go there. Shout out on the show.
How about that, by the way? Mike Williams, Scarlett walks by, both went to Clemson.
That's right. Clemson Tigers.
Yeah. Not a coincidence.
No. No.
Up next on Thing or Not a Thing, Odell Beckham Jr. saying goodbye to Baltimore yesterday. Doesn't have another team. Because no one's willing to pay him $15 million again.
Well, he's going to get – he might get a vet minimum deal.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw a report over the weekend. He's looking for one more big contract. He knows it's probably his last. I'm like, dude, you're like
it's
contrast.
Over. Yeah.
past that.
OBJ to the Jets. Thing or not a thing, Zagura?
I mean, that's probably fine.
Could him anywhere be a thing?
Yeah, I think he'll be in the league.
Where? No, no, no. But I mean, like, that it changes something.
No.
He's past that point.
Yeah.
So if you were him and you had all the money and the fame and all of the things that he has, where would you go?
I'd go back to L.A. with Miss Kardashian.
Yeah, and go play with Stafford and
yeah, or go play with Herbert.
Kids out
Although
there,
I don't
play
think Ian Harbaugh would.
No, they wouldn't. No, but I think he could play. He got along well with the Rams. Go out there, McVay will take you back on a nothing deal, and
yeah,
play there. Yeah, that's
Odell,
what I do too.
Puka, Cooper Kupp. Although they gave DeMarcus Robinson some not great money, but some decent money, I think, to
yeah.
come back.
Up next,
he should just go play with a good quarterback. I mean, New York's a fine city for him too.
Yeah, next two are both done.
Next two are
so
done.
The next two
so
are
not,
both done on this
not
list.
Not things,
but I would say this.
Let's talk about it anyway.
Thing or not a thing. How do I want to even phrase this? Great.
That's what they should have done.
No, thing or not a thing.
Not a thing.
Playoff teams missed out on the chance to add. Jeez, Griff, don't go dying on us.
Well, the Lions added Zeitler, so I think that's a playoff team.
Correct.
Cowboys have had a very strange offseason.
All in, comma, my butt.
My butt. Chase Young, so thing or not a thing, more teams should have been in on the former number one draft
pick. That is a top five mullet that I've seen recently.
It's a choice.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
It's breathtaking.
No, because the production isn't there. And it just hasn't been. He's just not the player that people thought he would be.
And Pedro told you he's a tough locker room guy, I guess, supposedly.
Yeah. Yeah, so, I don't know. He felt like about as safe a bet as could be. And
He did suffer catastrophic injuries.
He did. Yeah. Yeah. Major injuries and just hasn't been able to bend the same since. So
next on Thing or Not a Thing, Jadeveon Clowney. Who is slated, by the way, to meet with the Jets. Now to the Falcons, according to this on CBSSports.com.
Love it. I like that. I think it's good for him.
Isn't it something like how long ago that he – it's been like – has it been 5 or 6 years that he was been chasing like a long-term deal? I think he's given up on it now. But like he couldn't get that out of Houston, ended up going to Seattle.
Then to us.
Then to us. Then to Baltimore. Now to Atlanta.
He's played
great here year one. He was really good last year in Baltimore. But it's like it's a year deal. Then he's on to the next kind of it's a tough way to live, I would think.
Yeah.
Like moving every year.
Yeah.
It's tough.
Our guy Quinton Jefferson's playing this six different team in 6 years, and he's productive every year. It's crazy.
Yeah, it's tough. Tough on everybody.
The other three of these, I just feel like it's kind of Stephon Gilmore to the Raiders, Zaven Howard to the Vikes, Justin Simmons to the Bills.
Well, Justin Simmons, I think, could be a thing. He would fit right in. They lost Poyer and Hyde. They need a safety. That they still feel like they're in their window. That one makes sense to me.
Yeah.
Why no traction on Simmons?
He's probably waiting for something that he really wants.
What do you guys think the Raiders and the Vikings are doing?
I don't know.
No
like,
idea.
What are the Raiders
I don't know.
Doing?
I
so
trust,
the Raiders
I think,
are running Minshew out there.
Yeah. I think that Kwesi is a smart guy. I think they obviously got very positive feedback on Sam Darnold from Kyle. But, I mean, I think you look at that division now, and they are a distant fourth. I think the Bears are going to be much improved. I think that the Packers are solid. They were a playoff team a year ago, and the Lions went to the NFC Championship game. So, I think – I don't know. You really – probably should be just eyeing the number one pick next year. But
yeah, but there's all this talk that he's going to come up and get a quarterback in this draft.
So maybe
J.J.
Really
McCarthy
like
or – right, but you're not going to do better than the fourth quarterback.
Right.
And in the AFC West, I if you're Mahomes and Reed, everybody's coming back because look at our division. Outside of the Chargers, there's not anybody that concerns you.
Somebody put together – I mean, it was a fan bait thing, but they put together a – Justin Herbert to the Bears for the number one overall pick. So it was number one overall pick, and then it was a bunch of stuff like helping the Bears take on Herbert. Like the only thing that went back for the Chargers was the number one pick, and it was like Herbert and picks for the number one pick. That was nonsense. But is there a package that if you were the Bears, that would make sense? Like, you get the sure thing. You've got a ready-made roster. You'd have to pay him. So the beautiful thing about Caleb is
for five years,
you're not paying him. Yeah. If you're the Chargers, you tried with Herbert. It didn't work to the level that you thought. He's a sure thing, but you're having to rebuild around him. You got a new coach.
My sense of Caleb Williams and my sense of Jim Harbaugh make me feel like that might not be
– I think that's fair.
The best match.
I think that's fair. Yeah. But I don't know. As you think about that operation, I think if you're the Chargers, you don't ever trade a franchise quarterback. Herbert is a franchise quarterback. I'd never trade him. But –
could the Cowboys do something with Dak? Send them Dak and something?
I don't think Jerry can admit that he's wrong. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, that's why I think he kept McCarthy.
Yeah.
He's like, no, I'm right on this. Okay. Look how long he held on to Zeke.
Jason Garrett was there for
a
very long time.
Right. Yeah, he's got incredible patience when it's someone who he thinks corroborates him being right. I just don't – like, Herbert's hanging out there.
I feel like I could see Howie Roseman do something like that.
Like
trade Hurts
for Herbert? That would be very –
Hurts for the one.
Oh, Hurts for one overall?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if I'd do that if I were the Bears.
I wouldn't
do that if I were the Bears. Just because I'm not convinced that you can play that way.
Long
term.
Yeah.
Like, Jalen Hurts feels like a very – Like a Cam Newton type career out of him feels like the ceiling, which is amazing. MVP, all that stuff. But, like, you get battered.
Josh Allen. But the Bills can't trade Josh Allen.
They can't trade Josh Allen. No.
Now, if I was the Bengals, I would consider that. If I thought Caleb Williams was what, you know,
they're
Daniel Jeremiah thinks
about. They're in the same
spot,
though, that Allen. They're in the exact same spot they are in Buffalo.
I don't know about that.
They are.
He gets hurt all the time.
I understand, but
is. You have to.
He's the most popular human in the city since Pete Rose.
Yeah, but if let's say you did that, and you could then keep T and Chase, and you would have a rookie quarterback.
But there's just no way. I think it's so much more closer to the Allen. The only difference is just the injuries. He's more accomplished than Allen in terms of what happens in the postseason.
He's gotten farther.
Yeah, twice. The two times he's been healthy, AFC Championship, Super Bowl. So, what about Baltimore? Can they trade Lamar? And we were just having fun with nonsense.
Yeah, that would be one where I would consider it.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't know if the Bears would consider it. I feel like if you're
picking one, you want
a Herbert, thrower. Allen, yeah. Burrow.
Yeah.
I mean, it's Caleb Williams. Like, Daniel Jeremiah thinks he is Mahomesian.
But people are wrong about those quarterbacks all the time.
All the time.
So it's so hard to know what to make of it. Speaking of Daniel Jeremiah, we'll go over his mock. Coming up next, you'll listen to Cleveland Browns Daily on 850 ESPN Cleveland. Be part of one of the most passionate fan bases in the NFL. Join Next Gen STM, presented by Ticketmaster. The official waitlist of your Cleveland Browns being Next Gen STM is the best chance to become a season ticket member in future seasons. Visit clevelandbrowns.com/NextGenSTM to reserve your spot today. We missed the Griffect of the day yesterday.
Yeah, it was
sad.
All, it was a
That's
hole
my
in my heart.
I forgot to put it in the rundown.
But it was there?
He had a fact. I just didn't put
you,
it in
You
the
failed,
rundown.
Uno. Yeah. You're not going to get recognized much.
No.
If this type of stuff keeps happening.
I know. I really failed Griff. I feel
Come
bad.
On. You failed Griff. All right, let's do it. Griff, fact of the day. Hit it.
Fact of the day. Fact of the day. Fact of the day. It's the Griff fact of the day.
The North Carolina.
Whoa.
Whoa.
Where
Whoa.
Are the pins?
Where are the pins?
I don't know.
I don't know what happened to the pins on that one.
Oh my.
Can we try it again?
Yeah, we need a redo.
Let me see if I can find it. So you might want to go with the fact and then see if we can play it at the end here.
Okay.
The North Carolina State Wolfpack have more wins in the Washington Wizards home arena this season than the Washington Wizards do. The Wizards have played 31 home games. The Wolfpack played 5 games in the same arena. The Wizards are 4-27 at home this season. And as we know, the Wolfpack just won 5 games in 5 days to win the ACC title.
That is futility.
Yeah, it's awful.
That's absolute futility. Isn't Detroit like that too?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Terrible.
See, that's the thing. Like, you can just you be rebuilding forever.
They've never been good.
The Wizards?
Yeah.
Never.
Gilbert Arenas, Bradley Beal maybe was their peak.
I mean, they had at one point
John
both
Wall.
Chris Webber and Juwan Howard.
Yeah, but that you're going back to when that was the Bullets.
No, I understand.
Rex
but
Chapman.
I'm just trying to
Rex
find
Chapman.
Yeah, Chapman was on those teams. I'm just trying to find a time. They had a time when they had Moses Malone in the 80s.
Hmm?
But
huh?
I don't know if they've ever been. I think that's one of the worst franchises. Huh? I think that's one of the worst franchises in sport.
Yeah, terrible.
In our lifetime.
Griff, I would like for tomorrow's Griff Fact of the Day to be Griff is impressed by fill in the blank. What is a feat that a human being can accomplish? They
we
can
saw
accomplish?
Off air what he's impressed by.
I know. I would like a Fact of the Day along those lines.
Fact of the Day, Fact of the Day, Fact of the Day. It's the Griff Fact of the Day.
Yes. So much more punch. So much more pizzazz when the pins are popping.
Yeah.
Yeah, that was good. That was good. All right, good fact of the day. Sad if you're a Wizards fan of the Wiz.
Not sad if you were Nyheim Hines, though. He seemed quite excited
about
it.
No, he was thrilled.
Imagine,
Nyheim
though, like.
Was very happy.
I mean, that's a tough beat. NC State in that area.
Yeah.
I mean.
Your third fiddle.
You're hanging on to Jim Valvano dancing around.
I mean,
Wittenberg,
what year
oh, that's
was
a long
that?
Way. That's like 83.
That's what I thought, 83.
Yeah.
And he said they haven't been to the dance since 87?
No, they've been to the dance. They haven't won the ACC
won
since
the ACC.
Then.
Okay.
That would have been like a Rodney Monroe and a Chris Corciani.
Chris Corciani.
Would have been that. Yeah, but they haven't had.
No, it would be like a lower level Big Ten team. But in
they're
the
like,
ACC, they're a mid-level, but they're never great. They're never bottom. They're just
hoops wise,
stuck in purgatory.
They're always third fiddle in their own state.
Yeah.
Yes.
So there's you
sometimes
know,
fourth.
Yeah, with Wake.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, but always third, right out of the gates. There was a time where they had some juice in football, like when Chuck Amato first got there, when they had Phillip Rivers. They had a little bit of juice in football.
And they had Rivers. They had was Russ. Russ was there, right?
He was there, and then they benched him for Glennon.
For Mike Glennon was there.
Yeah, because the coach at the time didn't want Russ wasn't committed enough to football because he was trying to play like baseball.
Did Jacoby?
So Russ went to Wisconsin. Jacoby started at Florida, I think, and ended there.
I think I mean, that's a decent number of players that have started.
There was a ton of talent in that region. It's just they've never won anything,
right?
In really much of in those sports, they just haven't. In football and men's basketball, they just have not won. At the level that they're the ones I think I'm always surprised Carolina doesn't have a better football program consistently. They've had a ton of it, pros, but like the campus is beautiful, the facilities are beautiful, and they just have never been able to like become. No. And there's good talent in the region
for sure.
Yeah. All right, Daniel Jeremiah mock draft time. So he says he chose chaos with this, and this is what happens when you like or have to write for a website or
when
you
have
need,
to provide
clicks.
Like 8 mock drafts.
Yeah. You don't want to just keep doing the same thing over and over again. So in his mock draft this time around, he's got Caleb going 1, obviously. He's got Drake May 2, to Washington, Jaden Daniels. Then he has J.J. McCarthy, 4, to the Minnesota Vikings. So his trade would be, I'm guessing it would be 11-23. He doesn't have the terms of the trade, though, does he, in here?
It just says it was a trade.
Yeah, it just says it was a trade. So Vikings coming up to 4 to get J.J. McCarthy. Then Marvin Harrison to the Jets.
That?
So he has the Jets coming up to get Harrison.
So they'd have Harrison and Garrett Wilson with Rodgers?
I mean, be elite, but I just don't understand why the Chargers, who need young receivers,
they
would do that. That doesn't make any sense. I mean, DJ, come on, baby. We love you, but come on. Malik Nabers, 6 to the Giants. Let's see. So he's got Roma. Boy, that'd be an unbelievable haul for the Bears. If they get Roma Dunzie and Caleb Williams in one draft.
Yeah.
That would be crazy. I don't understand how – there's no way the Chargers would drop down to take a tackle. They have nobody for him to throw to.
Well, they did draft Quinton Johnson, a first-rounder last year. But that's it. I think that's it.
Didn't they take a guard a few years ago out of Northwestern?
Keenan Allen's gone.
Slater.
Yeah, Rashawn Slater.
He's got Penix, 13, to the Raiders.
Brock Bowers to Denver?
Again, Denver needs a quarterback, but Brock Bowers is – there's a lot of traction with him.
He's dominant at times at Georgia. Yeah.
Bengals take a tackle. He's got the Bengals taking J.C. Latham, a tackle out of Alabama. The Steelers take Tyler Guyton, a tackle out of Oklahoma.
It just stinks not having a first-rounder.
It's for the third year in a row. It's like,
3 years in a row, no first-rounder. And we're trying to, you know, what's going to happen at 54? I don't know.
Baltimore, Cooper DeJean. Is that how you say his last name?
Is that the kid from
– Jason Sehorn.
It's a kid from Iowa, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think he's going to play safety, unfortunately. So he's not going to be Sehorn.
Who knows our draft analyst?
He is.
He's on it, yeah.
I want him to play corner, but the experts think he's going to play safety.
Yeah. There you go.
So he would be next to Kyle Hamilton?
Yeah. Replacing Geno Stone.
That feels pretty good for them. Feels raveny.
Yeah. Yeah, it's brutal though. When you don't have one and you're kind of waiting on the rest of it to all sort itself out. All right, coming up next, we'll play a little higher or lower. You listen to Cleveland Browns Daily on 850 ESPN Cleveland.
Ever thought about hitting a golf ball inside a Cleveland Browns stadium? You know, funny, I have.
Same.
This is one of the things that anytime cool. I go into a dome, especially a dome, I don't know what it is, I always think it'd be fun to like just hit wedges.
I want to try to hit wedges from the field into the upper deck at the Baltimore Ravens Stadium. That's something I've always been very focused on and wanting to do.
Wanted to see? Yeah, that'd be fun. Well, you can do it.
It's high up there.
It's Upper Deck Golf. It's Friday, June 21st, Saturday, June 22nd. Enjoy a unique VIP golfing experience while hitting tee shots from the upper deck down to custom greens on the Brown Stadium field below. For more information, go to upperdeckgolfing.com and reserve your tee time today. It's upperdeckgolfing.com.
Yeah, we just announced that this morning.
That's very fun.
Yeah,
I like it. All right, time for a little higher, lower, presented by Keep It Fun Ohio from the Ohio Lottery.
Better.
They remind you.
Or worse.
To know the risks before you gamble. Are the following teams better or worser? Hello, Gibby.
Hi.
Good.
NFL power rankings, post-free agency, our friend Josh Kendall from The Athletic, who is who's pretty good at doing this.
All right.
It makes it a good time for the power rankings to reevaluate where everyone stands. We've listed the notable additions, notable losses for each team, but players acquired or lost via trade under release to help us get a clearer picture. For some teams, those moves haven't changed much. For others, they have warranted some movement up or down the rankings. We'll kick things off with your Cleveland Browns. Higher, lower, or just right, he's got the Browns at number 7.
Love it.
Post Super Bowl rankings, he had him at 8, so he has him up one spot. Now,
so he's always liked us.
Directly in front, the Baltimore Ravens. Directly behind us at number 8, the Cincinnati Bengals. That's 3 AFC North teams in the top 10. Public school math able to help me through that. Bishop, higher, lower, or just right at number 7?
So is the math part, if you gave a percentage, I'd have been more impressed. Is the math part just 1 plus 1 plus 1?
You're darn right it is.
That's right, yeah. All right, let me look at this. So 7 for us. Packers. So I think he's got Baltimore a little too high based on the amount of losses that they've had. Their losses are, I don't know if people really realize, not only Queen, Stone,
It's a ton.
Edwards, Duvernay, Beckham. I mean, it's a ton. But they also lost their entire defensive staff. So there's that part of it as well. So I would have Baltimore lower. I think this is right around the sweet spot for us. I think it's very appropriate that we're right there with Cincinnati. Because one thing that is, people talk all the time about, well, it's about Deshaun. It's also about Joe Burrow.
Yes.
So while Deshaun hasn't played a full season here, Joe Burrow has only played 2 full seasons out of 4.
Yep.
So he's on track. It's every other year for him. So he's on track for this to be a full season. But that's a huge question mark.
Yeah. It's a very big question mark. I like where we're at. This is, to me, a proper reflection of the talent that's on our roster.
All right. Next.
Higher or lower?
Number 1, the Kansas City Chiefs.
How could it not be?
It's actually funny. He says the reigning Super Bowl champs have made only one significant addition, signing the speedy but inconsistent Marquise Hollywood Brown. But honestly, the Chiefs could have signed only celebrity chef Alton Brown, and it still would be number 1 on this list.
Yep.
Yeah, plain and simple.
As long as they have him, and that now they got the defense, they can build this thing a bunch of different ways. But
yeah,
they're it.
Number 2, the San Francisco
greatness. It just is.
Number 2, the San Francisco 49ers. Any issues there?
No. They're a very complete team as well.
And who did they get to replace all those? They lost Kinlaw and they lost Armstead.
Jordan Elliott. They got better on the edges. Leonard Floyd and Yetur Gross Matos were 2 good additions on the edges.
Yeah. A little bit of a step back in the middle.
Sam Darnold for Dobbs, basically.
What do you think it would take for Detroit to catch them?
Detroit was whooping them. They just have to do it. I mean, Detroit, I thought, got better. DJ Reader, Marcus Davenport, Carlton Davis, as well as – and they lost Jonah Jackson, but now you could add Zeitler to that line. I think that's a very, very good roster.
Yeah, I think defensively, you know, they just got to shore up a couple things. And
Yeah,
that's it. They're right there. So you do wonder, like, did Kyle miss a window here? Like, is this what the legacy is going to be? Like,
How many knock times on can the he door. Get back? How many times can he
How many
get
times
back?
Can he keep getting
is this
back?
The year
and
that
biting
the seat
the
gets
apple?
Hot again.
No, the seat.
Does the seat get warm again?
No, the seat isn't.
I mean, it's a Marv Levy situation.
The seat is not
point.
Warm.
He's just young.
Just I mean, throwing
He's
it
young
out
and
there.
Brilliant, but it's kind of like a Marv Levy.
Yeah.
And they should have won, honest to goodness, probably should have won both of them.
Maybe.
All right.
He definitely should have won the one as coordinator of Atlanta.
Yeah.
Yeah, and he definitely should have won the first one when if Mosley just did what they had practiced and literally
yeah.
told him in the huddle.
Yeah.
They win that game.
Then they win. Yep.
So the Lions are 3. That takes us to number 4. Higher, lower, or just right? Zagura, the Houston Texans.
I don't have a problem with it. I think they're really good. You bring in Danielle Hunter, Danico Autry, Azeez Al-Shaair, who was on the Niners, Jeff Okuda. I mean,
Joe Mixon.
Mixon. I think they're good. I think they're really good. And if they get another receiver in there to go with, you know, maybe Mechie will be something this year.
Can you imagine going from, like, no hope
to hope
to. Because you land on the defensive end and the quarterback in the same draft. You land on the coach, and it flipped everything.
It flipped everything.
There was almost no path for them.
The crazy thing, what a great sliding doors or a what if would be, what if they had the number one pick and they took Bryce Young?
Oh, gosh.
Like, what if Davis Mills
yeah.
doesn't throw that pass to Jordan Akins? What yep. if they then don't get the two-point conversion and they
and
have
they,
the number one
pick? What if they had the number one pick? Who would they have taken?
I think they were going to take Bryce Young.
That's what it seems like. McClain was always quick when he asked him about it. He's like, yeah. don't let them tell you, like, they don't deserve all the credit for this. Like they,
yeah, know, they were taking Bryce Young.
They were taking Bryce Young.
Who may have been fine in a dome.
He's not C.J. Stroud in a period, though.
I don't believe so.
I don't think so either. This seems a little too high, though. This feels to me like
we're crowning
people. I love their roster.
It's like one of those Raiders teams where it's like preseason.
This happens all the time where it's like, We want to push them ahead a little quick. They're young. They're going to be really good. But is this Houston team – I mean, just think about, like, how tested and how proven, like, Baltimore, Cincinnati. I can't put us in that mix just because we haven't had this group do it, but we did it last year with all those quarterbacks. But, like, think about the hierarchy in the AFC in the last few years. Like, are we sure Houston's better than Buffalo in one off season?
No.
They're better than Cincinnati in one offseason. They're better than Baltimore in one offseason.
On paper.
I like them a lot, but it's rare that you go from burst on the scene to Super Bowl like that.
It was like the Raiders were supposed to do that.
Yeah, it just doesn't. Usually it doesn't work that way.
The Bengals kind of were like, did do that.
Yeah. Orlovsky cites them as like the Bengals in 21.
Yeah.
All right. Well, that takes me to number 5 and next. Higher, lower, or just right. Bishop, the Green Bay Packers.
I don't get this.
I'm fine with them being the third.
We're crowning them to
agreed. I'm fine with them being the third or fourth NFC team behind San Francisco, Detroit, and then I'd probably have Philly still ahead of them, and then 4. I'm fine with that. But they're not better than all these AFC teams.
He's got Philly 16,
so he don't like them at all. So I'd have a lot of these AFC teams ahead of them. The ones that I already mentioned.
Yeah. Probably 6, 7, and 8, to be exact.
Yeah, maybe Miami. Who'd Miami lose? Why's he got Miami so far down here? Oh, Wilkins.
Yeah, but, I mean, they added some good players.
Yeah, I think that's just too high. What is the – I don't understand the Eagles. You just think it's just wore out its welcome, huh?
Yeah, apparently so.
Next.
Higher or lower?
All right, Zagura, this one's for you. We'll start with number 9, the Dallas Cowboys. Really have done nothing. Mm-mm. Adam Schefter was on the ESPN radio morning show this morning, and he was like, this might be the end. Like, they've shown no interest in extending Dak. McCarthy's on his last year. Like, is this a put up or we're going to blow the whole thing up?
Not at Jerry's age.
I don't know. This is
– I don't understand their offseason at all. I don't know how you didn't fire McCarthy. I don't know why you didn't bring in Belichick. I don't know why you didn't try.
No notable additions. I think that's pretty wild. I don't know. I like the Falcons better than them right now. The mm-hmm. Falcons are way down the list. I like that Falcons team with Kirk Cousins.
Well, he's got Buffalo behind him. I think the Rams are better than them. Even with the loss, he's got Tampa Bay too high.
Yes.
But, I mean, like – I don't know. Philly, for sure. Atlanta, I like better.
Yeah. I don't get it.
We have breaking news.
Oh, yeah?
Yep. From Ian Rappaport. The Browns and wide receiver Jerry Jeudy have agreed to a 3-year contract extension worth up to $58 million, including $41 million fully guaranteed at signing, per me and Tom Pelissero, the deal negotiated by Equity Sports and CEO Chris Cabot.
I don't know Chris, but I think he's got a hell of a satchel.
Tremendous satchel. That's what
great
I would say.
Great satchel game, yep. Is what I would say, based on what I've witnessed.
Yep.
That the satchel game was strong.
Yep.
On him today. Look, you said this when the acquisition. Like, this is what you try to do here. When this happens, they renegotiated the contract last week, end of last week, and now you get the extension today.
So here's what I think. Number one, what you're doing is right now you're going to a season with your top three receivers on the last year of their deal, and so now you get Jerry Jeudy. When they made the trade, I said the best thing you could do was extend him now. And why? Because if he is what the Browns believe he is, this will save the Browns a lot of money over the next three seasons. Because if he comes in here and lights it up and is a number one and all the things that everybody thought he was going to be coming out of Alabama, this is a great deal. It reminds me a little bit of when the Browns kind of paid Chief based on what they knew or believed he would become, and then he certainly has made them look very good there. That's what this, I feel like, is as well. So Jerry Jeudy, when you made the trade, obviously you were doing it to have him here. $41 million fully guaranteed at signing, according to Ian Rappaport, 3 years, $58 million, so under 20 a year. You're paying him to be a top-end number two or a solid number one. I mean, that's what that money is. And so that's what you hope Jerry Jeudy will be. I know that seeing him around here today, he and his family are quite pleased. So that is, I think what this team does is they are planning for now and the future, and I think they did a very good job here getting him and paying him, because if he came off of a year where, let's say, he had 1,200 yards and 10 touchdowns, you're paying him 25 a year.
Right.
So this is that's what the Browns are gambling on, that they're right about him, and they're going to lock him up, and Jerry Jeudy is going to go ahead and take that right now.
Yeah, and you think about in two off seasons with Elijah Moore and Jerry Jeudy, high-end talent.
Weapons.
And weapons, and you think about what Ken Dorsey is brought here to do Deshaun Watson is to feed those weapons, spread the ball around, make it very difficult to defend. And Jeudy is going to be a huge part of that, not only now, but now into the future. And so now that's the future of the position group here.
Yep.
It's pretty well locked up. So that is a very good job. And good job of you, Gibby, getting that on. There you go. So much more to come. You listen to Cleveland Browns Daily on 850 ESPN Cleveland.
All right, so the big news of the last couple of hours, the Browns and wide receiver Jerry Jeudy agreed on a three-year contract extension worth up to $58 million, including $41 million fully guaranteed at signing. Ian Rappaport first with it. And so there you go. So this is some you laid this out at time of acquisition.
I did.
And that's exactly what's happened here. This is an ownership group. It is a front office that is ultra aggressive, that will take advantage of others' inabilities to get things done or their other vulnerabilities, and will be ready to pounce and then be able to capitalize on top of the pouncing. And that's what happened here.
It is. And again, it's an opportunity. They have done a good job where they hand out extensions to people, maybe a little in advance of the performance that is commensurate with such an extension. And they've gotten it. So this is, you know, you're hoping this is another David Njoku situation where he got that extension and then became the Pro Bowler. And that's what you're up with Jerry Jeudy. And if so, you've stolen a guy who coming out of Alabama.
Sure thing.
Absolutely. And now he's here. He's going to feel the love. He's going to feel wanted, motivated, all of that. Great offensive system. He's got his idol, Amari Cooper. Whatever the best of Jerry Jeudy is, I believe you'll get that this season.
Yeah, and now you have a group where you're talking about Jeudy, Elijah, Chief, Amari for a while here.
Nick Chubb,
Watson. But I mean, I just meant for pass catchers.
Sure.
Now these guys can all – they're all going to be here for a while.
Yeah.
So that's nice.
It's real
now
nice.
Now you can build that camaraderie, the cohesiveness that you need. So love it.
I love it as well.
Very good stuff. Very good stuff. All right. We are back tomorrow. Thanks for listening, everybody. Next Level coming up next. Cleveland Browns Daily, 850 ESPN Cleveland.